Hello everyone, let's discuss frontal advancement theory, fractional flow and water flood performance surveillance in this particular session. Coming to the Buckley and Leverett frontal advancement theory, Buckley and Leverett developed a well-established theory called the frontal displacement theory. For proving that theory, he gave two equations, fractional flow equation and frontal advance equation. Coming to the fractional flow equation, In this you can see that the fractional flow of water equal to the flow rate of water divided by the total flow rate. The total flow rate will be equal to the summation of water plus oil flow rate. Now you can see that for deriving this particular equation, I considered a linear displacement in a tilted system. So you can see that this is a reservoir. Over here, this reservoir is tilted at an angle of alpha. Let this be the height of the reservoir. Let this be the length of the reservoir. Over here, this is a injector well and this is a producer well. Now you can see that my water front, my flood front will be moving. Okay, as I'm injecting water, the flood front will move. Okay, and plus water will be produced at the producer end, because this water will try to sweep the oil plus water towards the producer end. Alright, okay. Now the flow rate of oil can be given as Q naught equal to K naught A upon mu naught into dp naught x plus rho g sin alpha. Over here, rho g sin alpha, we have introduced this particular term. The reason is because we have a tilted reservoir. Flow rate of water can be expressed as this particular term. Now, rearranging this particular equation 1 and 2, I will get this term in the left hand side, and the right hand side, I will get this term. Okay. Now, as we know, the del p naught upon del x minus del p W upon del x will give me the capillary pressure. Again, in the definition of capillary pressure, we have already discussed that the difference in the pressure across two immiscible phases, that is the difference in the wetting phase and the non-wetting phase when it is present inside a capillary tube, gives me my capillary pressure. Okay, again, we are considering my reservoir as a bundle of capillaries. All right, okay. Now this flow rate of water can be written as my fractional flow of water into the total flow rate, and my flow rate of oil can be written as 1 minus fractional flow of water into flow rate of what? Flow rate, total flow rate. Again, we know that my fractional flow of oil plus my fractional flow of water will be equal to 1. Okay, now I am using these two concepts and I am placing this in equation number 3. Okay, now I'm placing that. My final equation that I will be left out will be this. Okay, what I am assuming over here is that the del pc upon del x, that is my capillary pressure term, I am assuming it to be 0. Okay, on considering my del p, capillary pressure to be 0 and converting it into field units, my final equation, that is my final fractional flow equation, will be 1 minus 0.00127 into k naught a upon mu naught t into 0.433 into del rho sin alpha upon 1 plus k naught upon kw into qw upon q naught, where my k naught is my effective permeability of oil in millidarcy, area is my should be in feet square, mu naught is my viscosity of oil, qt is my total injection flow rate in barrel per day, del rho should be in the gram per cc, and sin alpha, again we know the whatever angle is there, you will have to place that, and the oil viscosity and all the viscosities, that is water and oil viscosity, should be in centipoise. And I will get my answer, my fractional flow of water in barrel per barrel. Okay. Now for a horizontal case. Okay. This case is valid for a tilted reservoir. Alright. Tilted reservoir or an angled reservoir at some angle alpha. Now if I'm considering an horizontal reservoir where my sin alpha equal to 0, what I do is that I place my sin alpha equal to 0, then this entire term will become 0. Okay. See, my entire term over here will become 0 if I place sin alpha equal to 0. So whatever I am will be left out with will be FW, that is the fractional flow of water, equal to 1 upon 1 plus k naught upon q naught into mu w upon mu naught. So I will be left out will be FW is equal to 1 upon 1 plus m, where m is my mobility ratio. Let we have already discussed what is mobility ratio in our previous session. Let's move further. Very important trend over here, FW versus saturation. My graph obtained will be of this kind of a trend. Now corresponding rel pump relative permeability curve is also there, relative permeability versus saturation. Okay, now let's look at the theory part. When water saturation is at irreducible level, water flow will be 0. Hence, my flow rate of water and my fractional flow of water will be 0 and Q naught will be maximum. So, at this case, what they're discussing here is this case where my irreducible saturation is there. Okay, in this case, as you can see that my fractional flow of water is 0. That is, my relative permeability of water is 0 at this particular point. And at this particular point, see, look at the fractional flow or the relative permeability of oil. It is maximum in when I am having an irreducible water saturation. Now, at irreducible oil saturation, oil flow will be 0. Hence, my flow rate of oil will be 0 and my flow rate of water will be maximum and fractional flow of water will be 100%. So, what they are discussing about is at this point. At this point, I will get my residual oil saturation. Okay. Now, corresponding to residual oil saturation, you can see that my oil rate has gone 0. Okay. That means I am producing the maximum amount of water that is producible. That means my flow rate is 100%. In field, this fractional flow of water can also be termed as my water cut. We know my fractional flow of water plus my fractional flow of oil will be equal to 1. Okay. Now, in the previous slide, we have seen that in a horizontal reservoir, that is when I am having sin alpha equal to 0, I will get this particular equation. Okay, where 1 upon 1 plus mu naught upon mu naught, mu w upon mu naught into kRO upon kW is equal to my fractional flow of water. As we know, in my relative permeability ratio versus my water saturation, this will be the trend that I will be obtaining. And again, we know that my relative permeability of oil to relative permeability of water equal to A into E raised to B SW. Okay, this is the relation we will be having when we are considering relative permeability ratio. Okay, now, so what I will be doing is that I will place this equation in over here. Okay, on placing that, my new fractional flow of water will be this. Okay, now if I'm differentiating my dFW upon dSW with respect to saturation, okay, on differentiating it, I will be left out with this particular equation. All right, okay, so this is a very important equation. We will take this equation into play when in coming up slide. Okay, as of now, you have to understand that my fractional flow of water plus fractional flow of oil equal to 1. Okay, and this particular graph is very important, and my fractional flow of water is also termed as my water cut. Okay, all right, now let's move further. Okay, in this particular page, I have discussed or I have compared various factors affecting my shape of the fractional flow curve. Okay. Now, let's look at the very first trend, which is my how the fractional flow curves changes with changing oil viscosity. Alright, okay. Now, again, let's look at this particular equation. My fractional flow of water, for this particular equation is valid for a horizontal reservoir with, that is my sin alpha is 0 at 1 upon 1 plus m. Okay, 1 upon 1 plus 1 upon m. Okay, again, what is m? M, we know m equal to my ratio of displacing phase, the ratio of mobility of displacing to the mobility of displaced. Alright, where my displacing is my water and displaced is my oil. Now, if we want to look at the reason, okay, now if I am looking at oil viscosity, that means oil viscosity is present in the denominator part. Okay, of over here, it is present in the denominator part. So, if I am reducing this mu naught, if by chance, if I have this reduced mu naught, then my overall FW will be less. Okay, or vice versa, if I am having higher viscosity of oil, then my FW will be more. Alright, okay, now let's look at this concept over here. Assume that I am considering this 40% water saturation. Okay, from 40% water saturation, again this curve is for 0.5 centipoise of oil, this is for 2 centipoise of oil, this curve is for 6 centipoise of oil, and this particular curve is for 10 centipoise oil. Okay, that means I have different trends or I have different curves when I am having different oil viscosities. So let's look at the how it affects my water cut. Now let me consider a 40% water saturation, and I am plotting lines from 40% water saturation. Okay, now on intersecting my 0.5 CP line, you can see that correspondingly I am getting around 15% of water cut. Okay. Now, from same 40% line, if I am going upwards and if I am intersecting this 2 centipoise curve, then I will be getting around 30% of water cut. Okay. Now, similarly, from 40% line, if I am going to and intersecting further up, so I will be intersecting my 2 centipoise oil and the corresponding water cut I am getting will be 45%. Now, similarly, if I am extending the line towards my 10 centipoise oil curve, then I will be obtaining around 70% of water cut. Okay, so what does this mean? You can see that if I'm comparing at one particular saturation, that means I will be having increased water cut when I'm having increased oil viscosity. Okay, this particular thing can also be seen in the formula also. Okay, so this particular graph very very nicely shows how my water cut increases with increasing oil viscosity. Why this particular thing occurs is because we know when my m is greater than 1, it is unfavorable. Okay, it is unfavorable in nature and my recovery factor will be low. That means my sweep efficiency will be low, aerial sweep efficiency will go down. When my m is less than 1, which is a favorable case, okay, and my sweep will be appropriate. All right, okay, so we will always try to get my m less than 1. Got it? Okay, now for to keep m less than 1, as we know, my m equal to my KRW upon mu w KRO upon mu. Okay, now whatever thing that we do, that is if I am increasing this viscosity of water or if I am decreasing this viscosity of oil, okay, these two terms will help us to decrease the mobility ratio. If I am getting a decreased mobility ratio, that means it is a favorable condition. All right, okay, now let's look at this particular case where I compared my fractional flow curves for an oil bed system and the water bed system. Okay, again let's take the same example only. Let me consider a 50% line over here. Okay, let me consider 50% water saturation, and correspondingly I am plotting for over here. Okay, so corresponding to 50%, my when I am plotting into a water cut curve, I will be getting 50% water cut. Now from 50% saturation, if I am plotting the line towards my oil bed system, then it will be around 85 to 90% water cut. So you can very well very clearly say that if I am having a water bed system, then my fractional water cut at a particular saturation will be less as compared to that of a oil bed system. Again, I am comparing at similar water saturations only. This will be the grain. Okay, in my water bed system, what you can observe is that my water is attached to the surface of the rocks, all right, and whatever oil is present in between the is present in the pores. Okay, so that's why if I am trying to that's why over here you can see that my fractional flow of water will be comparatively less at a particular saturation of water. But when I'm talking about a oil bed system, at that time my oil over here will be stuck to the rock grains. Okay, if I'm going for any sort of a displacement, at that time there is high chances that most of the oil will be left behind because it is stuck to the surface of the sand grains. Okay, as a result, at a particular saturation, if I'm going for a water flooding project in a water bed system and a oil bed system, my water cut will be less in a water bed system as compared to that of a oil bed system. Let's look at the effect of dip on my fractional flow curves. I have a three condition: down dip system, no dip system, and up dip system. Okay, now in the previous slide we have seen the big formula over here that we have used. Okay, so what I have did is that in that particular formula I took x as this particular term, that is 0.00127 into 0.433 into del rho into area into permeability upon mu naught. Okay, I took this term, I considered this term as x, and I took the denominator term, that is kr upon krw into mu w upon mu naught as my y. See, I have taken y. Okay, now let me consider for up dip system. Now for up dip system, you can see that I have this formula, that is fw is equal to 1 minus x sin alpha upon iw upon 1 plus y. Okay, now one important thing that you need to take into consideration is that 1 minus of x sin alpha upon iw. Okay, so that means whatever we are doing over here to increase this particular term, okay, whatever things that we are doing to increase this particular term in the numerator, it will reduce my water cut. All right, okay, now for a down dip system, let's see. For a down dip system where my sin alpha is less than 0, now if I'm keeping my sin alpha less than 0, so I will be getting a positive over here. Okay, that means whatever term I am getting over here, that means I am getting a positive term in the numerator. So whatever thing that we do to reduce this particular term, okay, then it will, then I will get a reduced fractional flow of water. Look at this particular case only. Let me consider this 50% saturation line. Okay, now if I'm plotting curves, okay, let's say if I'm going vertically and plotting my fractional flow corresponding to it, so I will be getting around, see, I will be getting around this, let's say 15% of water cut for a up dip system. For same water saturation only, if I'm plotting it to a no dip system, I will be getting around 25% of water cut. Similarly, if I'm again plotting it towards my down dip reservoir, at that same reservoir, at that same saturation, I will be getting around 80% of water cut. So you can very well see that at a particular saturation, if I'm comparing the water cut for an up dip, down dip and a no dip system, you can very clearly say that for an up dip system, I will be having a comparatively lesser water cut as compared to that of a down dip system. Let's look at the effect of water injection rate. Okay, again, as we have seen that for up dip system, whatever we are trying, since it is a negative term in the numerator part, whatever we are doing to increase this particular term will help us to reduce the overall fractional flow of water. Okay, so that means if I'm keeping my IW less, okay, if my injection rate of water is less, then this entire term will be more. Okay, if this entire term will be bigger, then 1 minus this bigger term will give me lesser fractional flow of water. Okay, so for an up dip system, I will keep my injection rate of water small to have a smaller fractional flow of water. Similarly, for a down dip system, see, for a down dip system, again, I have 1 plus this particular system. So what we have to do is that we have to keep this particular system less. Okay, since it is in positive in nature, we need to keep this term to be less. Now, to keep this particular term less, I will require my injection flow rate to be more. Okay, that means for a down dip system, keep my injection flow rate of water to be high to have a smaller FW. All right. Okay, now let's look at this particular case where I have where in effect of increasing viscosity of displacing fluid is compared. Ratio will be equal to my relative permeability of water divided by viscosity of water in divided by my relative permeability of oil upon my viscosity of oil. Okay, so whatever I am trying to do to reduce this mobility ratio, that means if my M is less than 1, it is my favorable region. Okay, so I will always try to get my mobility ratio of less than 1. Okay, now as we know that if I am increasing my viscosity of water, okay, if I am increasing this viscosity of water, that implies my mobility ratio will go down. Okay, alright, now let's look at this concept over this year also. Let me consider 50% of water saturation. Okay, now if I am plotting a line towards this, and this blue line is for my when I am injecting water with polymer in it, and this black line is for when I am injecting water a simple water system. Okay, now for a 50% of water saturation, if I am comparing this fractional flow curve, see, at 50% saturation, the corresponding water cut that I will be obtaining will be around 35% water cut. Okay, now for the same 50% saturation, if I am plotting it towards my water system, then I will be getting around 90% of water cut. So you can see a drastic increase in the water cut when I am going for a simple water flooding, and when I am going for a water flooding with polymer added to it, my overall water cut will reduce. That means my fractional flow curve will tend to move towards the right side. Okay, all right. Now, what are the inferences obtained? Let's look at it. My inferences obtained is that if my M increases, my fractional flow of water increases and my fractional flow of oil decreases. Very obvious. When my M decreases or when my mobility ratio decreases, my fractional flow of water decreases. As a result, my fractional flow of oil increases. Very, very obvious thing. Okay, all right. Now, let's move further. Over here, it is given my fractional flow of water versus my water oil ratios relationship is been given. Okay, now for a reservoir fractional flow of water versus my reservoir water oil ratio. Okay, again, this fractional flow of water will be my water cut. My fractional flow of water at the reservoir will be equal to my flow rate of water divided by my flow rate of oil plus flow rate of water. Okay, now if I am dividing my flow rate of oil on the numerator and the denominator, I will be getting this type of equation. Okay, now my water oil ratio will be equal to my flow rate of water divided by my flow rate of oil. Okay, so this can be rewritten as this. Okay, now taking my flow rate water oil ratio as a subject of equation, my final equation that I will be obtaining will be flow rate of, that is the fractional flow of water divided by 1 minus fractional flow of water. Okay, now if I'm told to find out the relationship between my reservoir fractional flow of water and my surface water ratio. Okay, for that again my fractional flow of water will be equal to Qw upon Q0 plus Qw. Okay, now this is at the reservoir condition. Now to bring this water up on the surface, I will be multiplying Bw. Okay, that is Qw into Bw upon Q0 B0 plus Qw Bw. Okay, now dividing Q0 on both numerator and the denominator, I will be left out with this equation. Now if I want to, now this capital Qw, that is my water oil ratio, will be at the surface will be equal to my capital Qw versus my capital Q0. Okay, so if on placing this, on using this funda over here, my fractional flow of water at the reservoir will be equal to my Wr at the surface into Bw upon B0 plus Wr surface into Bw. Okay, now taking this Wr surface as the subject of equation, I will be left out with this particular concept. Okay, where my B0 upon Bw into 1 upon fractional flow of water minus 1, and the final equation that I will be left out with be B0 into Fw upon B0, B0 into Fw upon Bw into 1 minus Fw. Okay, now coming to the relationship between my between the reservoir flow rate, between the reservoir water ratio and the surface water ratio. So the for the reservoir, we know it will be Q0 up Qw upon Q0, which will be equal to my, when I'm taking this flow rate at the surface, which will be equal to my capital Qw into Bw upon capital Q0 into B0. Okay, so this capital Qw upon Q0 will be my water ratio at the surface into Bw into B0. So this is the relationship between my reservoir water ratio and my surface water ratio. Now coming to the surface fractional flow of water and my surface water ratio, for my, this will be the surface water ratio will be equal to my capital Qw upon Q0 plus Qw. Now on placing my capital Q0 on both numerator and denominator, I will be getting, this will be my relationship between my fractional flow of water at the surface and my water ratio at the surface. Flow rate, that is surface fractional flow of water versus my reservoir fractional flow, for that my equation obtained will be this. Okay, where my FWS or my surface fractional flow of water will be equal to B0 upon Bw into 1 upon Fw minus 1, where this Fw is the reservoir condition, plus B0. Okay, so these are the five equations that you guys have to remember. It's a very important gate level equations over here, and questions can be asked from this particular concept. Alright, now let's move further. Let's discuss frontal advancement theory. The Buckley leverage theory estimates the rate at which an injected water bank moves through a porous medium. The approach uses fractional flow theory and is based on the following assumptions. My flow is linear and horizontal. Water is injected into an oil reservoir. Oil and water are both incompressible in nature. Oil and water are immiscible, and the gravity and capillary pressure effects are negligible. Over here, volume entering the element minus volume leaving the element will be equal to the change in fluid volume. Okay, that means this particular element has been taken. This small element over here of length dx has been taken into consideration. Okay, overall this is my width of the reservoir, this is my length of the reservoir, this is the height of the reservoir. A small element dx has been taken into consideration, and my flow into the, this is my flow entering into the small element, this is my flow leaving the flow element. Now flow of water entering the element will be equal to qt into flow rate, fractional flow of water into dt. Volume of water leaving the element will be qt into fw minus dfw into dt. Subtracting the above two expressions gives the accumulation of water volume within the element in terms of differential changes of the saturation of dfw. On subtracting both, I will be getting this equation, which will be equal to fy dx into dsw upon 5.615. On simplifying it, I will get my qt into dfw into dt is equal to a5 dx into dsw into upon 5.615. Separating the variable gives me my dx by dt at saturation of sw equal to my velocity of velocity of the water flowing at saturation of water equal to 5.615 into qt, where qt is my injection water flow rate, upon a5 into dfw upon dsw at my saturation. Alright, again where my V will be my velocity at any specified value of saturation in feet per day, area is my cross-sectional area in feet square, flow rate, total flow rate equal to oil plus water barrel per day, and dFW upon dSW equal to the slope of FW versus SW curve at some saturation. Now again the same equation over here, okay, where now I am considering my QT will be equal to my whatever I am injecting. Okay, since I am going for a volume balance, so whatever I am injecting will be produced at the other end, that I am assuming it. On integrating it, I will get my x equal to, x means my distance from the injection for any given saturation of SW, where my x will be equal to 5.615 into IW into T upon FI into DFW upon DSW. This should be DSW. Again, this would be DSW. Alright, so this is my final equation, a very important equation over here. And questions have been asked from this particular equation, where IW is my injection water injection rate, W injection is, will be my cumulative water injection injected in barrel, T will be in time, and XSW, that is my distance from the injection for any given saturation. Alright, okay, now let's move further. Okay, now this particular graph again, that will be the fraction flow of water versus my saturation. Okay, so this would be the fraction flow of water versus saturation, and another graph over here is given, which is my DFW versus DSW. This graph indicates that both derivatives are identical, that is DFW upon DSW at point A equal to DFW upon DSW at point B. So you can see that at point A and my point B, my DFW and versus DSW at point A equal to my DFW upon DSW at point B are same. Okay, which implies that multiple water saturations can coexist at the same position. But this is physically impossible. Buckley and Leverett in 1942 recognized the physical impossibility of such a condition. They pointed out that this is an apparent problem, and it can, and this is due to the neglect of capillary pressure gradient term in the fractional flow equation. This capillary term is given by this. Okay, we actually in the when I was deriving my fractional flow equation, at that time we neglected this capillary term. Okay, and when I neglected this capillary term, I will be getting this kind of a phenomena, where I will be having two DFW upon DSW at same DFW upon DSW at two different locations in the reservoir. Okay, now to reduce, to mitigate this problem, what they did is that included the above capillary term when constructing the fractional flow curve, which produced a graphical relationship that is characterized by the following two segments, that is a straight line segment with a constant slope of DFW upon DSW from SW to SWC, that is my coordinate water to my flood front saturation. What they did is that they introduced they plotted a tangent line. Okay, they plotted a straight line from my saturation of water at Connet and my flood front saturation. Okay, so they introduced this term, the straight line term. Okay, they introduced it, and second term is the concaving curve, which decreases slope from SWF to 1 minus SOR. Okay, that is from saturation of flood front to 1 minus SOR, they introduced a concaving term. Point onwards, my DFW upon DSW will be decreasing continuously. So you can see that as I am increasing my water cut after my flood front, after I have got my flood front saturation, my DFW upon DSW will continuously go down. What do you mean by a flood front saturation? Let's look at this. Let's say I have an injector well over here, I have a producer well over here. Okay, this is my reservoir. This would be my flood front. Okay, that is, this will be my distance of my flood front, and the particular and this is saturation versus x distance. Okay, now the saturation at this point will be my flood front saturation, SWF. Alright, okay, to mitigate this particular phenomenon of having DFW upon DSW at two particular points, see in this graph also you can see that at two different points, that is at point A and my point B in the reservoir, see at point A and point B in the reservoir, I will be getting some this kind of a trend, which is wrong. Okay, over here I am getting 2 DFW upon DSW, which is undesirable. To mitigate this particular case, I introduce a capillary pressure term. And how did I introduce my capillary pressure term? By drawing a straight line, that is capillary, that is my fractional flow curve with my capillary term can be determined by getting this tangent. Okay, this tangent, that is straight line from my coordinate water saturation to the flood front saturation. So this particular area over here, see this particular area under this particular curve, that this is accounting for my capillary term. okay, which we had neglected during my derivation of my fractional flow. Got it? Okay. So this is the solution given by Buckley and Leverett in 1942. Once I got my flood front saturation, okay, above that flood front saturation, I will be getting a concave curve, concaving trend. Okay, concaving curve is obtained, that is from my flood front saturation to my 1 minus SOR. And correspondingly, the DFW upon DSW is continuously decreasing. See, continuously my DFW upon DSW is decreasing as I am increasing my water cut above my flood front saturation. Got it? Okay, now let's move further. Coming to Welch theory, let's look at this theory. A more elegant method of achieving the same result was presented by Welch in 1952. This consists of integrating the saturation distribution over the distance from the injection point to the front, thus obtaining the average water saturation behind the front. So you can see that again, this is an injector well, this is my producer well. Okay, over here this is my Conneaut water saturation, this entire is my Conneaut water saturation. This particular figure is between the saturation of water with the distance x. Okay, water saturation distribution as a function of distance prior to the breakthrough into producing well we are discussing. Now let this point over here is my flood front point, okay, and this particular saturation is my flood front saturation, and this 1 minus SOR will be my water saturation, okay, maximum water saturation possible. All right, now you can see that the average water saturation behind the front would be this SW bar. Okay, so this is my SW bar, which is my average water saturation behind the front. Got it? Okay, now the situation depicted is at a fixed time before water breakthrough corresponding to an amount of water injected. At this time the maximum water saturation, that is SW is equal to 1 minus SOR, has moved a distance x1, its velocity being proportional to the slope of the fractional flow curve evaluated for the maximum saturation, which as shown in the figure is small but finite. The flood front saturation SWF is located at a position x2 measured from the injection point. So you can see that my maximum, see this particular region over here will have my maximum water saturation. Okay, my flood front over here has reached my x2 distance. All right, and this will be the saturation that I will be obtaining at my flood front, and this will be my average water saturation behind the flood front. Got it? Okay, see from this curve also, this is a curve for fractional flow versus my water saturation. This is my irreducible water saturation. Okay, and this is my curve. This blue line indicates my curve. I am plotting a tangent from this particular point. Tangent is intersecting this curve. Okay, now this point what I am intersecting with the fractional flow curve will be my waterfront saturation at the waterfront, and the corresponding FW will be my water cut at that particular flood front. Okay, now if I am extending it, the line towards my fractional flow of 1, that is my water cut of 100%, okay, so this would be my breakthrough SWBT. This will be my breakthrough water saturation. So what does this breakthrough means over here? Okay, let's look at the diagram over here. If I am getting a breakthrough, that means I am achieving this point. Okay, this green color over here. So this would be my breakthrough saturation SWBT. Now let's apply a material balance formula over here. So as we know, my Q injection or my injection rate will be equal to my X into A. This will be the volume into porosity into SW minus SWC. Got it? Okay. SW bar is this. Okay. That means maximum water saturation behind my flood front. Okay. SW minus SWC. SWC is my irreducible water saturation. Now taking this thing into subject of equation, I will be left out with SW bar minus SWC is equal to Q injection upon XA phi. Now taking X as the subject of equation, again this thing we have already seen before, okay, in the previous slide we have seen that X is equal to Q into T upon Fi upon DFW upon DSW. This Q into T can be rewritten as Q injection upon Fi DFW upon DSW, okay, where Q injection equal to my total flow rate into my time of breakthrough. Okay, now XF or my length, medium length, will be equal to my Q injection upon Fi upon into DFW upon DSW, okay. On rearranging this particular equation, I will be left out with this. Okay, now we know my pore volume injected will be equal to my q into t upon FIL, okay, where my qt is my total flow rate and tbt is my breakthrough time. So 1 upon pvi, this is my 1 upon pore volume injected at breakthrough, will be equal to my dfw upon dsw at flood front saturation. Okay, now to calculate the average water saturation in the reservoir at time of breakthrough is given by material balance as this particular equation. Okay, this is a very important equation. Rearranging this particular equation, I will be left out with this, where SWBT minus SWI equal to PVI, which is my pore volume injected at breakthrough, equal to 1 upon DFW upon DSW at saturation of waterfront. Okay, now taking this DFW upon DSW as my subjective equation, I will be left out with this particular term. Got it? Okay, now let's move further. Let's calculate my time of breakthrough and cumulative water injected, a very important page over here. Okay, this is important for GATE. Questions have been asked from this particular concept. Now, as we have seen before, my length will be equal to 5.615 into injection of water injection into time of breakthrough upon FI into DFW upon DSW at flood front saturation. Now, we know my pore volume will be equal to FIL 5.615. Okay, now taking time as my subjective equation, I will be getting this. Okay, this is the time of breakthrough will be equal to my pore volume upon IW upon 1 upon DFW upon DSW, where TBT is my time of breakthrough, TPV is my total flood pattern pore volume, L is my distance between the injector and the producer. Okay, now to calculate what would be my cumulative water injected at breakthrough, so W, capital W, will be equal to IW into TBT. Now IW we know, now I am, whatever TBT I obtained, I will be placing over here, so my cumulative water will be PV upon DFW upon DSW. Got it? Okay. Now to find out my cumulative pore volume that is injected. So to find out my cumulative pore volume being injected, I will be dividing my cumulative water injected at breakthrough divided by the pore volume. That will be equal to 1 upon DFW upon DSW. Okay. So this is the equation for finding out my cumulative pore volume of water injected at breakthrough. Got it? Now determination of water saturation at the front from the fractional flow curve. Now again, we have already seen that. See, this particular point was my irreducible water saturation, okay, and this the blue line was my fractional flow curve. What I did is that I plotted a tangent, whatever intersection point I am getting at the fractional flow, that would be the corresponding saturation would be my flood front saturation, corresponding FW or the corresponding water cut that I obtained will be my fractional flow water at my flood front. Okay, now the point that I obtained at fractional flow water at 1, and the corresponding water saturation that I obtain will be my saturation at breakthrough. Okay, all right. Now let's say if my initial water saturation is not at my cornered water saturation. Okay, that means if my initial water saturation at for a particular reservoir were not equal to that of a irreducible water saturation. Okay, now let's say my irreducible water saturation was 10. And my initial water saturation where I started my water flood project was at 20. Okay, now what I do is that again I fractional flow water will remain the same for any system. Okay, now at this particular case where my initial water saturation is not equal to the irreducible water saturation, what I do is that now I plot a line towards my fractional flow. Okay, now whatever intersection point I am getting, now from this point I will draw a tangent. See, from this point I will draw a tangent. Again the same thing, I will draw a tangent. This would be my flood front saturation and this would be my fractional flow of water at this flood front, and the intersection point of when I am having my flood front saturation equal to 1, the corresponding water saturation will be my water saturation at the breakthrough. Got it? Okay, now let's look at this figure. This is my water saturation profile with distance x from the injector. This is my injector well, this is my producer well. You can see that again this particular the region over here is my cornered water saturation region. I will be plot at this point, this point will be my 1 minus SOR. Okay, now you can see that with time my flood front is moving ahead. Okay, see my flood front is moving ahead. At this point my water breakthrough has occurred. Okay, now you can see that this is my flood front saturation or my saturation at the breakthrough. And so you can see that, and if I am plotting the average, that is this point, SWBT will be this term. Got it? Okay. So again, what will be my average saturation? If someone is asking what will be my average saturation at breakthrough, if a question is asked to calculate my average saturation at the breakthrough, then my answer would be SWBT. That means when my FW equal to 1, at that time the corresponding saturation I am getting will be my SW breakthrough or my average saturation at breakthrough. Got it? Okay. Now let's move further. Now you can see that the stabilized zone is that particular saturation interval, that is SWC, cornered water, to my flood front saturation, where all the points of the saturation travel at the same velocity. Now you can see that from my cornered water saturation, see, from my cornered water saturation to the flood front saturation, so this region will be my stabilized zone region. The saturation zone between my flood front saturation and 1 minus SOR, where the velocity of any water saturation is variable, they are termed as my non-stabilized zone. So this particular region will be my non-stabilized region in my flood front saturation and 1 minus SOR. Okay, time t equal to 0, this will be my, let this circle, small circles, be the representative of a capillary. Okay, now you can see that, so these small circles, you can see that this will be my cornered water present. Got it? Now as I am injecting at time t1, as I am seeing, my flood front has been injected over here, so you can see that the nearby, that is this, let this be the injector well, let this be the producer well. Okay, so you can see that nearby my water saturation is increasing. Okay, now as the flood front is moving further away at time t3, you can see that as my flood front saturation is moving away, you can see that my water saturation is rising, average water saturation is rising in the reservoir. You can see that average water saturation is rising in the reservoir at t4. Now this is the time where I have got my breakthrough. Okay, so you can see that this point is my breakthrough point. See, this point is my breakthrough point. And my, if I want to calculate what will be the average water saturation, somewhat around here will be my SWBT or my average water saturation. Alright, okay. Now let's move further. Now, this particular curve over here, let's discuss. So this particular trend, so this will be my start of the flood. Okay, saturation profile at some distance x at the start of the flood. Let this be the injector and let this be the producer well. You can see that there will be segregation of my initial gas saturation, initial oil saturation, and initial water saturation. Okay. Now, over here, I have started my injection. Okay. On starting my injection, you can see that I got some interference. So you can see that my flood front is moving further. Okay. So I can definitely see a water bank over here, oil bank over here. Now, if someone is asking what is my additional oil recovery, so this particular region that I am shading over here is my additional oil recovery that I obtained because of going for a water flooding project. Alright, okay, now let's move further. Now let's look at the case at breakthrough case. Okay, that is at this particular point, breakthrough. Now this is the equation we have already discussed before. This is the particular equation where my main equation will be, time of breakthrough will be equal to my pore volume injected upon my injection water upon 1 upon dfw upon dsw. This will be my cumulative water injected at breakthrough, where wibt equal to I into t, that will be equal to my pore volume upon dfw upon dsw. If I am told to find out my cumulative pore volume of water injected at breakthrough, this will be the equation. Alright, I have already discussed this in previous slide. Now let's move further. So let's discuss the case after breakthrough. Okay, now you can see that I already discussed that stabilized zone means when my saturation is between my cornered water to my flood front. Okay, now non-stabilized zone means the zone from my cornered water saturation to 1 minus SOR till my flood front saturation. See, this is the point where I am getting my flood front saturation. Okay, so till my flood front saturation, whatever I was doing, that is I was drawing a tangent line and I was getting my water saturation breakthrough. Okay, that was applicable. But after that point, that is in my non-stabilized zone, I cannot use that particular concept again. Okay, that means, see, once I got the breakthrough, after my breakthrough, the non-stabilized zone that I am obtaining, I will have to account for a different kind of a technique to calculate what would be my average saturation behind. Alright, okay. For that, what you will do is that, see, from the, on drawing the tangent on the fractional flow curve at the flood front, I obtained my SWBT. Okay, Now, what I do is that now if the corresponding saturation, if I am plotting at my fractional flow curve, I will be obtaining this particular saturation. Okay. Now this particular saturation, the fractional flow corresponding to it is not equal to fractional flow equal to 1. That means obviously even after this point also I will be obtaining my oil. Okay. If it were equal to 1, then I was supposedly to get my fractional flow of oil to be 0 and fractional flow equal to 100. But since it is not 1, that means I can still produce my oil in this case. Alright. Okay. So what I do is that I draw a tangent over here. See, I draw a tangent at this point. Okay. Now I got this particular point. Okay. Now again, if I'm going down, again, if I'm plotting down to the fractional flow curve, I will be getting a new saturation. Okay. Now this new saturation is also not equal to 1. That means still I can go further. Got it? Okay. Now let me show this in a big picture over here. Okay. This would be my SWF or my floodfront saturation. Okay. Let this be my FWF, where my fractional flow at floodfront. Let this be my floodfront equal to 1. That is fractional flow equal to 1. Okay. Now I was obtaining this particular trend over here. This was the actual fractional flow curve. Got it? Okay. Now this was a tangent that I drew. I got this particular point. And what I did is that I plot a line. So what I did over here is that I, from this FW equal to 1, I plot a line, a vertical line towards my fractional flow curve. See, the corresponding whatever I'm getting SW2. Okay, SW2. Now you can see that my FW is not equal to 1. That means still I can go further. Okay, that means at this point also I will be getting my oil. Now what I do is that I again plot a tangent over here. From this point whatever I obtained, I will plot a tangent. Now this new tangent will give me a new SW. See, now if I am putting a line or a vertical line towards my fractional flow curve, I will be getting a new fractional flow. Again, this fractional flow is not equal to 1. Okay, that means we can still go further. Now if I'm going further, now by doing this we can go further and further till I get my fractional flow equal to 1. So you can see that in this particular figure I have gone till my 8 points till I reach my FW equal to 1. So this is how you solve the equation. So this is how the concept works in the non-stabilized zone. Got it? Okay. We'll be having a DFW versus DSW curve over here. Okay, DFW versus DSW. Now, as the water saturation increases, as I'm getting more points from the tangents, okay, I will be getting a DFW by DSW reducing. See, as I'm getting new saturation point after in my non-stabilized zone, my DFW versus my DFW upon DSW will keep on decreasing. Okay, so that's another important point that you need to take into consideration. So if you want to find out what would be my saturation, average water saturation after my breakthrough, that will be equal to SW2. That is SW2 bar equal to SW2 plus 1 minus FW2 upon DFW upon DSW. Okay. Now, what does this mean? Let's see. This was a tangent that I initially obtained. Okay. Now, if you want to find out the slope, my slope will be DFW upon DSW. At my flood front, okay, that will be equal to 1 minus FWF upon my SW2 minus SWF. Okay, so this is how you calculate my slope. Got it? Okay. Now, calculate my QI or my cumulative pore volume injected. So this is the formula that I will be using. Qi is equal to 1 upon DFW upon DSW. We have already seen that before. Now my water injection will be equal to my pore volume into Qi into Ea into Eb, or equivalently it can be written as water injection equal to PV equal to SW2 minus SWI Ea into Eb, where water injection equal to the W injection equal to cumulative water being injected, PV is my pattern pore volume, Ea is my aerial sweep efficiency, and Eb is my vertical sweep efficiency. Now the total time to inject my W injection barrel of water is given by T equal to W injection upon IW, where IW is my injection rate and W injection is my cumulative water injected. Alright, okay, now let's move further. I have a particular numerical over here. This numerical I have discussed for case when I am having after breakthrough. This is the given data. Calculate the following: when my water saturation at producing well reaches my saturation of water equal to 0.7, I have to calculate my reservoir water cut, surface water cut, reservoir water ratio, surface water ratio, average water saturation in the swept area, cumulative pore volume of water injected, cumulative water injected, and my given data is my oil FPF is given, water FPF, initial water saturation, slope of tangent at SW2 equal to 0.7 is 0.89 already given, and pore volume is 775,000 barrel is already given. Initial water saturation is 20% given. Okay. Now this is the graph which has already been given with us. Now to calculate my reservoir water cut, it has been already given. Okay. That means the tangent I have drawn, a tangent towards my fractional flow curve. Okay. Now from this tangent, what I did is that I got a line. I plot a line vertically downwards towards the fractional flow curve. And corresponding to that point, whatever FW I am getting will be my reservoir water cut, and corresponding to this point will be my 0.7. At 0.7, I will be getting my 0.93 as my water cut at reservoir. Now to calculate my water cut at surface, I know the formula. I place the terms that are given in the equation and I place my reservoir water cut as 0.93. I got my answer as 0.922 as my surface water cut. To calculate my reservoir water ratio, I know the formula. This is my formula for calculating my reservoir water ratio. On placing that, my reservoir water ratio I calculated to be 13.28. All right, okay. Now, calculating the surface water ratio, to calculate surface water ratio, I know the formula over here. I placed the values, I got my surface water ratio to be 16.27. Now, to calculate my average water saturation in the swept region, now we know the formula again. In the question, I am been given my slope of tangent at SW2 equal to 0.7. Okay, that is at 0.7, my slope of tangent has been given. So to calculate my slope of tangent, dFW upon dSW at 0.7, what I do is that, see, I will take one point over here. This is my slope of the tangent. Okay, this is my slope of the tangent. Okay, now dFW. Now, on the y-axis, I have 1 minus 0.93. Again, why 0.93? Again, because I am considering this particular triangle. Okay, this particular triangle where this is 1 and this is 0.93. Okay, and upon SW average, where SW average over here is this term. SW average minus 0.7. Doing this, I will take my SW average as a subjective equation. On taking that, my SW average will be 0.78. Okay, so my average water saturation in the swept area will be 0.78. Now to calculate my cumulative pore volume injected, so cumulative pore volume injected will be equal to 1 upon dfw upon dsw at saturation of water equal to 0.7. okay, now on placing that, we have already seen this, the derivation in the previous slides. On placing the values, my answer would be 1.123. now to calculate my cumulative water injected, this is the formula to calculate my cumulative water injected, where pv is equal to pore volume into qi into ea into ev. Okay, now on placing all the values, since EA into EV is not given, on placing my values of PV into QI, my answer would be around 870,325 barrels into EA into EV. Okay, now let's calculate the numerical at breakthrough. We need to estimate the following at the breakthrough of injected water. We need to find out the flood front saturation. We need to find out the average saturation in the reservoir. We need to calculate the water cut and the water ratio under reservoir conditions at the flood front. And we also need to calculate the pore volume of water injected. This is the given data. This graph has already been given to us. Okay, now to calculate the saturation of waterfront, this will be my waterfront saturation, 0.596. okay, to calculate the average water saturation in the reservoir, as I already discussed before, my average water saturation in the reservoir will be equal to my breakthrough saturation. Okay, that will be my 0.707. to calculate what is the water cut at reservoir condition, the fractional flow of water corresponding to the flood front will be my water cut at the reservoir condition. So 0.78 will be my water cut. To find out my water ratio, we know the formula to find out my water ratio at the reservoir condition. So all we have to do is that we need to put the values. So my answer would be 3.544.
to calculate my pore volume injected, pore volume injected is equal to qi is equal to 1 upon dfw upon dsw. Okay, now on placing now what we have to do is that now we need to calculate what would be my dfw upon dsw. So for that we know that dfw upon dsw at my fluorine saturation will be equal to 1 minus 0, where 1 will be at this point 1 minus 0. Okay, so 1 minus 0 that means swt minus swi. Okay, so 1 minus 0 upon swt minus swi. On placing the values, I will get my dfw upon dsw slope will be equal to 1.97. On placing 1 upon 1.97, 0.507 will be my pore volume injected. Okay, now I'm leaving this particular question to work for you guys. You need to calculate the fraction flow of water at the surface, and you need to also calculate the water oil ratio at the surface. So please write the answers in the YouTube's comment section. Okay, now let's move further. Now to calculate the aerial sweep efficiency, as we know, so see, when the mobility ratio is greater than 1, so you can see that my flood front will be moving very fast. That means my water rate will be more than my oil rate. Okay, so as a result, you can see that there will be a lot of region that has been unswept. For a mobility ratio less than 1, you can see that a proper sweeping action is being taken into consideration, and there will be a very less unswept region. So important factors determining the aerial sweep efficiency are mobility ratio, flood pattern, cumulative water injection, and directional permeability. We have already discussed these things before. All right. Okay. Now let's look at this particular graph over here. So this is my water bank over here. This is my oil bank. This is my water invaded zone. This is my non-invaded zone. Okay. So mobility of water will be KRW upon KW at the rate water breakthrough, and my mobility of oil would be KRO, or my relative permeability of oil at the rate initial water saturation, upon mu naught. Now you can also see that from this graph, where mobility ratio has been compared with the aerial sweep efficiency. So you can very clearly see that as I am having less mobility ratio, my aerial sweep efficiency will be more. Okay, and as my mobility ratio increases, that is if when it goes more than 1, you can see that my aerial sweep efficiency is also going down. All right. Okay, now let's move further. Now over here you can see that before the breakthrough, if I want to calculate the mobility ratio, this will be my mobility ratio, and after the breakthrough, if I want to calculate the mobility ratio, this will be my mobility ratio after the breakthrough. Okay, now to calculate, now there are three different phases where I can calculate my aerial sweep efficiency, and in all the three phases my formula to calculate my aerial sweep efficiency varies. So before breakthrough, this will be my equation to find out the aerial sweep efficiency, where EA, or the aerial sweep efficiency, will be equal to the water injection, or the cumulative water injected, divided by pore volume into SWT minus SWI. To find out my aerial sweep efficiency at breakthrough, this will be the formula that I will be using. To find out my aerial sweep efficiency after breakthrough, this particular formula will be used to calculate my aerial sweep efficiency after breakthrough. Okay, now let's move further. Now let's discuss water flood performance study. So water flood performance study can be discussed at wellbore, in the reservoir, and at the surface facilities. In the wellbore, we will be having injectivity index and oil plot analysis. At the reservoir, I will be having water flood surveillance, where I will be discussing voidage replacement ratio and cumulative voidage compensation. At surface facility, we will be looking at the water quality and the injection criteria fulfillment. Coming to the water flood performance analysis at the wellbore, so I have a hall plot analysis. The slope of the hall plot is interpreted as an indicator of the average well injectivity. Again, productivity, we have already seen that productivity will be equal to my Q upon delta P, and my injectivity will be equal to my Q injection upon delta P. Okay, where delta P will be my injection rate flow rate, where my delta P will be PIF, which is the flowing water mole pressure in PSI, minus my external pressure. Okay, my injection rate, so this is my term of injectivity, where PIF is my injection pressure, and PE, external pressure, means my reservoir pressure. Okay, again, we will always try to inject at pressure above my reservoir pressure. Okay, so that's why delta P will be this. So injectivity is Q injection upon delta P. Now at normal condition, the plot is a straight line.
kinks on the plot indicates changes of injection conditions. So this is my injection flow rate, where IW is equal to 0.00708 kh into PWI minus P average is upon mu ln RE by RW plus S. Okay, so what I did is that I took this entire term as C. Now IW is equal to C into PWI minus P average. Taking PWI minus P average as subjective equation, I got IW upon C. On integrating on both the sides with 0 to T, I got this as my 0 to T integration is equal to PWI minus P average into DT equal to WI by C, where WI is my cumulative water being injected. Okay. Now if I'm plotting my PWI minus P average from 0 to T versus DT versus my cumulative water injection, I will, if I'm getting a straight line, okay, if I'm getting a this line, black line, I will be getting no change. That means whatever injection I am going for is proper. If I am getting an increased slope, okay, point B, that means I have a abrupt skin. If I am getting point C, then it is a gradual skin. Okay, if I am getting a reduced slope, that means I am getting a negative skin. Negative skin in case of an injection well means my well has been fractured. Okay, let's say if my whatever injection pressure I am giving, it is more than the fracture pressure. Okay. And if I'm getting a negative skin, that means my formation where I am injecting has fractured. Point E means my abrupt skin, abrupt negative skin is obtained. Okay. Now this will be the trend when I'm plotting pressure versus time. So average reservoir pressure, this will be my average reservoir pressure. Okay. And this will be my, and the blue line indicates my bottom wall injection pressure. What are the factors affecting the injectivity index? Let's see. Mainly geological constraint, where permeability, size of pores, or heterogeneity will affect the factors, will affect the injectivity index. Geomechanical constraints like wellbore integrity and induced fractures will be affecting my injectivity index, as well as my transport constraints like my relative permeability and hysteresis and wettability. So these are the factors that affect my injectivity index. Okay, now let's move further. Now let's discuss a case of water flood performance study at the reservoir condition. For that, we will be having this water flood surveillance. So we will be using two different tools over here, that is BRR and CVC, where BRR is my voidage replacement ratio. Where BRR is equal to my injected reservoir volume to the produced reservoir volume. Okay. When I'm talking about injected reservoir volume, that will be equal to my BW into water injection divided by plus BG into gas injection. Okay. Gas injection rate, but since I am talking about water injection only, we can neglect this particular term over here, divided by my produced reservoir volume. My produced reservoir volume, in it I will be having oil volume, water volume and gas volume. Got it? Okay. Now when I am having my BRR greater than 1, that means when I am keeping my injected volume greater than the produced volume, my reservoir pressure is being maintained or increased for that particular month, which is very obvious. Now, BRR less than 1, this case means my reservoir pressure declines for that particular month. BRR less than 1 implies that I am injecting less amount of volume as compared to that of the volume I am producing. Okay, important note point over here is that due to the leaking faults or poor cement casing bond or discontinuous sands depleted prior to water injection or a gas cap or an inactive aquifer, these are the common reason to lose some of the injected water to the areas outside the floodable pore volume. Okay. So these reasons may lead to my BRR going less than 1. Okay. Even after injecting more amount of volume, but the effect won't be felt at the reservoir. Okay? If I'm injecting more amount of volume, but still because of this reason, my reservoir pressure won't be maintained. Okay. Because of this heterogeneity or because of this disturbances in the reservoir, my reservoir pressure is not been maintained. Okay. All right. Now you can see in this particular figure over here. So this is voidage versus time. So till this time, I have not gone for any water injection, but from this point onwards, I have gone for voidage compensation over here. That means I have started my injection from this particular point. Got it? Okay. Now let's discuss CVC or the cumulative voidage compensation. It gives the ratio of the total water injected since the date of inception to the voidage created by the production. Okay, that means CV will always be less than 1. CVC over here is means my cumulative water injection to the voidage created.
to the total void edge created. Okay, again this will always be less than 1, which is very obvious. Okay, so in this particular figure you can see that my total cumulative void edge over here, this white region over here indicates my total void edge. Okay, now from this point onwards I have started my water injection. So this portion indicates my cumulative void edge been compensated, and this blue portion indicates my water injection, that is my void edge been compensated by my injected water. Okay, so this is how my CVC and my VRR works. Okay, now let's move further. Now coming to the water effect performance study at the surface condition, that water quality parameters for injection, these are the desired water quality parameters, where my pH is 6.5 to 8.5, turbidity in NTU unit will be less than 0.5, TSS or the total dissolved total suspended solid will be less than 2.5, filterability should be greater than 6 liter per 30 minute, dissolved oxygen in ppm should be less than 0.02, scaling tendency should be less than 10% of hardness, my corrosion rate should be less than 1, residual chlorine should be 0.2 to 0.4, iron should be less than 0.1, my bacterial count, that is my SRB, should be nil, and my GAB should be 1 to 10 raised to 3. Contaminants present in the water at the source, I can have sand, silt, clays, bacteria and dissolved gases. Generated in the system, I can have corrosion and scale products, biomass. Unintentionally, that I am contaminants that I am adding will be in insoluble materials from the treatment, such as chemical oil and grease from the pumps, etc. What are the problems faced during water injection? So I can be having availability of water throughout the project life. This can be one of the problem that is being faced. Okay, that means percentage pore volume to be injected should be available with us. Another problem that says content or the total suspended solid content, the desired value is less than 0.25. okay, so if I'm not achieving that particular condition, then I can face a potential problem. My TDS content or the total dissolved solids content should be less than 15 ppm. My plugging tendency is also a major problem. Okay, if I'm having high amount of plugging, then it will reduce the injectivity index of the well. Oil and grease content is other important content, is another important problem. My desired value is less than 10 ppm. My scaling and corrosion can be a potential problem again, because it will damage the well completion equipments. Alright, okay. So these are the performance study that we will do at surface condition. Okay, where we will be looking at the water quality mainly and the contaminants present in the water. So that's all for today. Thank you and Jai Hind.